and I'm an academic, I'm a climate scientist who works at the university. So I'm very much an enthusiastic amateur when it comes to visualisation and communication. It's not my main job. My main job is to I'm just trying to understand what's happened to our climate and our weather, what's going to happen in the future. So as scientists, we tend to communicate in rather simple ways, normally through scientific papers and making fairly boring static plots. But there are sort of a whole group of us who are trying to experiment and trying to improve our communication with public and policymakers and so on, and to make quite important decisions about what happens with our climate in the future. So how does our weather and climate system work? So here is an animation of 2015 from space. This is satellite data from the METSATs to orbit the planet. And as you can see, the satellites drop out data every now and then, which is why you get little black gaps. But you can see the weather systems of our planet moving around. You've got the very spotty cloud in the tropical regions. You've got the storms that fly across the tropical regions. Dump rain on the UK quite regularly. You also see sort of very big tropical storms, because it's September, October time, which is when you get the hurricanes and the typhoons. You can see a big typhoon cloud through Taiwan and China at one point, and various hurricanes around the Caribbean area. So this is what our planet looks like from space. It's a very dynamic, evolving, moving feature that we have to try and understand and also simulate, and we'll come on to a little bit later on. But of course, you know, we've had these satellite observations since about the 1970s. It hasn't always been like that. We haven't always had satellite observations monitoring what's going on with the planet. So we had to kind of make do with interpreting older data. So this is kind of where we started. On the left-hand side, you see an old barometer. This is a Fitzroy barometer. So you may recognize the name Fitzroy from the road outside. Fitzroy founded the Met Office back in the 1860s, and he passed around these barometers to various locations around the UK to start weather forecasting back in the 1860s. Up on the top right, we have buckets. So this is how sea surface temperatures were measured at sea during that time. People used to throw buckets over the side of the ship, pull up the bucket, stick a thermometer in it, and record those measurements. And we've got a lot of those measurements which we try and have to interpret nowadays. But those types of bucket changed over time, they got more sophisticated. So we have to use and interpret this data to learn about what happened in the past. At the bottom on land, we have measurements. So we have what are called Stevenson screens. So the thermometers are held in proper containers which insulate from the wind and so on, so we have to try and interpret this older data as well. So climate and weather is very much an observational science. Once the time is gone, you can't remember the time machine to travel back and retake observations. You have to make do with what we've got. So what have we got? So if we go back, look over the last 150 years, this is temperatures across the planet since about 1850 up until the present day. So I've plotted all of the data on one diagram. So running from left to right, we've got the 1850s, and then each decade coming up to present day. And there's probably several things you might notice straight away. Over on the left-hand side, there's lots of blank areas, white areas, where we don't have any data. And as I say, we can't go back and take more data, we have to make do with what we've got. And as you come forward in time, obviously, people's thermometers and everything start becoming more common, and so we start filling those gaps. The blue colours appear, which are relatively cold temperatures, and then as you come up to present day, you see the colours mainly changing to red as temperatures have increased over the last few decades. So that's all the data we have, but the temperatures, for example, all plotted in one diagram. But you know, it communicates a message to the public, for example, very simple message that the planet has warmed over the last 150 years. Now if we're looking at, for example, a few years, this is 1850, this is the temperature observations we have for that time. Lots of gaps, but you can see where you know there are two thermometers over Europe and parts of North America, and lots of ships sailing around. There's no Panama Canal, no Suez Canal, so they have to sail around the southern capes of the continents, so that's why we have observations in those regions. But coming forward, 1938, things have improved slightly, we have more observations. And it was actually at this point that we started noticing that something was happening. we have more observations covering more of the planet. We're seeing quite warm temperatures up in the northern regions and many other regions as well. But it was actually this time that we actually noticed the thing that was going on. And so this chap, Guy Callender, was the first person in 1938 to realize that actually global temperatures had increased. This is the diagram from his 1938 scientific paper where he showed that global temperatures had increased by about 0.3 degrees Celsius over the previous 50 years. So he only had 147 data points at that point. He managed to collect it all by hand. He added all the numbers together by hand. There were no computers. He had hundreds of notebooks which he recorded all the data in and did all the sums, by hand. And he was actually an amateur. He wasn't a professional scientist. He was a professional scientist, but he's an amateur meteorologist and just a very enthusiastic data collector. There's also one other interesting point to note in this diagram. Right up in the top right-hand side, you'll notice there's a little line labeled CO2 effect. So Callender was also the first person to collect carbon dioxide measurements through the atmosphere from various locations that over the previous 50 years, pieced them together, realized the carbon dioxide had increased. And by this point, we also had an understanding that carbon dioxide was a greenhouse gas, and therefore warming the planet. So now it comes to 2016. This is the temperatures that we have this year. It's the warmest year on record. We're seeing temperatures more than 2 degrees above normal in many parts of the world this year. But there's still gaps. We've still some various gaps over places like Africa and Antarctica and South America, where we don't have enough data to have reliable temperature measurements of the air temperature in those areas, and then the Arctic as well. So we can pull this data together and try and understand what's happened to global temperatures over the last 150 years. But we also have to recognise that because there's all these gaps and data is uncertain, we have to recognise that there's uncertainty in those estimates. And so I quite like this diagram from John Kennedy here at the Met Office, who puts together many of these data sets of temperatures. And he's called this the uncertainty wiggle diagram. So it's trying to communicate that, of course, temperatures have increased, which is the blue, you can see the blue line, temperatures have increased since 1850. But there's a grey shading area which represents our uncertainty in those measurements of global temperature. And he's also added different blue lines, which are kind of different plausible possible past that might have happened given the uncertainty in our data. So I quite like this way of showing the grey shading. Come out to the we've tried these different ways of communicating temperatures increased. And many of us have experimented in different ways. And I was actually emailed by a colleague who said, why don't you try it a slightly different way of doing it and try it as a spiral diagram. And so back in May, I produced this spiral version of global temperatures. So it's the same data, just plotted on a spiral diagram. So you're seeing temperatures from each year and each month plotted in this spiral form. And you can see as time goes on, temperatures increase as they spiral outwards. And you can see that the temperatures are increasing out towards the end. And I've also put on here some various lines. There's a line for 1.5 degrees and for 2 degrees, which are the various targets set by the United Nations agreements on climate change. That's what we must try and stop temperatures getting up towards. We must try and, if we can, avoid breaching those temperature targets. So this tries to communicate the fact that we're temperatures increased, we're getting closer and closer to those particular targets that the UN has set that we want to try and avoid. And so I was quite surprised by what happened to this diagram. It went quite viral. It was shared millions of times on Facebook and social media and so on. And it seemed like it appealed to non-scientists. Various scientists I spoke to didn't quite understand why this had gone viral, but apparently the public seemed to resonate with people who weren't scientists. They seemed to understand this way of presenting the data far more simply than understanding a normal line graph like the previous example. So, we're very much used to just presenting things as boring, static line diagrams because that's what we do in our day job, but it turns out that my colleague had the idea of making a spiral version, apparently caught on to something, and they seem to help communicate the data in a far more effective way to the public. It was then a bit of a shock when we watched the opening ceremony of the Olympics to see this diagram appear. I knew nothing about it. I nearly fell off my chair when I was watching the opening ceremony. Since then, I've made a three-dimensional version. So if you want to see a three-dimensional version, this is the global warming tornado, if you like, or the vortex. Now, I make this very simply, so I probably don't use the right tools, but I use tools that I'm used to using in my day job, which I can just about make do what I would like them to do. I'm sure there are better ways of trying to visualize this type of data. Data's open, if people want to use it, it's there for people to use. I don't know if this is a more effective way or not, as a static version, if you like. But as many good ideas, I wasn't the first to come up with this. It turns out that an artist then emailed me and said, well, I made a 3D printed version of this a couple of years ago. So this chap in Australia emailed me and said, this is temperatures in Sydney. And I 3D printed it, so you can actually see the ripples in the cup are representing temperature changes in Sydney over the last 100 or so years. Of course, so it's not just what's happening at a global level. We also have to try and communicate to people where they live. No one experiences global temperatures. That's just some concept that we like to talk about because it's measuring kind of some kind of average over the planet. But it's also what happens locally that's very important. So we have to try and communicate the changes that we're seeing, that people are seeing in their own backyards, about how that's linked to what's going on more broadly as well. So here's global temperature again. I've deliberately squished the scale because I want to also communicate the fact that if you look in any particular region, so this is a particular region over central England in the UK, and you can see there's a lot more ups and downs, a lot more variability from year to year. We live in a part of the world where it's very variable, whether you get hotter years and colder years just by chance, because the rest of the way that our weather systems work. We live in the extra-tropical region, but we see those storms coming across. It's very noisy part of the world to live in terms of our weather. But even in this very small region, which is 1/20,000th of the planet, you can still see signal of global temperatures increasing on our local temperatures. You can still see the familiar shape of global temperatures increasing is actually true in our own backyard as well. So communicating that fact to people who may not appreciate, because there's so much noise and so much variability, they may not realise that actually their temperatures are increasing, because it's very difficult in your own personal experience to experience a small change over 30 years or 50 years. But we also have to try and communicate that things are changing where people live in their own backyard. If we go to a different part of the world, it's slightly different. So if we go to Kenya, we have relatively good observation, say, from Kenya, it's a different picture. Things are increasing. You can still see very clearly that the fact that temperatures are increasing in Kenya. And it's actually far more clear for someone, for example, who lives in Kenya, because there's less variability from year to year. The tropical regions where Kenya is, there isn't this variability of the weather from year to year. It's far more stable. You see far smaller fluctuations from year to year, and so you can quite clearly see the signal of increasing global temperatures at a local scale. So if you live in Kenya, you will have noticed that the temperatures have increased far more easily perhaps than if you lived in the UK. So again, this is just trying to think about different ways of communicating what's going on to people whose lives are potentially having to change because of what's going on. They may need to plant different crops, for example, or so on, because the climate is changing. It's not just temperature that's changing, of course. We have relatively good observations of sea ice since we've had satellites. So since 1979, satellites have been monitoring the state of the sea ice in the Arctic, for example. And this is showing an animation showing the fraction of sea ice in each area of the Arctic over the last 37 years or so. There's a black spot in the middle, which is the North Pole, where we can't quite observe all the way up to the pole because of the way all satellite orbits work, but that's improved over time. You can see that whole figure back in 1979. But you can also see that the amount of sea ice we have has declined quite drastically over the last 35 or so years in this animation. We saw particularly low year 2012, and all of the last few years have been way below normal. So things are changing. And the big question, of course, for the public and policymakers is, okay, so things are changing, but the main question is why? And of course, we don't have other planets to go to perform controlled experiments to try and understand why. You know, we can't go and build a Large Hadron Collider to go and try and understand what's going on. We have to make do with what we've got, and so we also have to make do with our simulations of the planet. So we have to try and build a mathematical model of what's going on. We have to try and simulate the entire planet inside a computer. So we can't go away and perform experiments on lots of different Earths. So we have to make an Earth. So this is one of Doug's cartoons, Doug sitting over there, which I quite like, to just try and communicate what we have to try and simulate if we're going to try and simulate the entire planet. So we have to try and simulate, have to represent the Earth's orbit around the Sun, how it tilts, how it rotates, we have to represent the clouds, the ice sheets, the oceans, how the sunlight enters the Earth's atmosphere, how it interacts with all the molecules in the atmosphere, how the atmospheric currents respond, what happens to the ocean, how the ocean's currents respond. We have to think about what's going on the land, we have to think about volcanoes, we have to think about human impacts such as industry putting particulates into the atmosphere, as well as greenhouse gases. We have to think about how trees react to all those different changes, the crops, and of course the human influence on the landscape, land use changes. We're building more and more concrete over the land areas, and we have to take that type of thing into account as well. So we're trying to include a multitude of factors in building our mathematical models. So I'm just going to show a little movie now, which I think is quite a nice description of what goes into a climate model. So obviously we have the Sun, we zoom in on the Earth and the Moon. And so the way these models are built, we take the Earth and we split it into different boxes. So we separate the little grid cells, a mesh, we tend to build a mesh over the planet in the atmosphere. So we split the atmosphere into different boxes. We have to do that for the atmosphere and for the ocean and for the land areas. And inside those boxes, we have to solve the equations, the physical equations, the chemical equations, and we have to try and represent clouds, how clouds interact with the sunlight and the reflective radiation from the Earth. And inside those boxes, we also have to try and represent mountains, for example, forests, crop areas, land areas, rivers, how rivers outflow into the ocean, how those outflow interacts with the sea, and how it forms clouds, how clouds go back and rain over the landscape, and therefore what happens to the rivers again. We have to represent industry, the pollution that comes out of our factories, for example, how that interacts with the atmosphere. We also have to represent what's going on in the ocean. So the ocean also has a three-dimensional grid going into the depths. The ocean currents, upwelling, for example, near the coast, warm and cold water flowing around, the turbulence in the ocean. We also have to think about the biology. So we have plankton and other forms of life which take up carbon and then sink the bottom of the ocean. So we have to think about how that affects what's going on to the system. It's an amazing complex system. So we have to essentially split the planet's boxes, solve the equations on all those boxes, feed that into a big supercomputer. That's apparently a supercomputer. And out at the other end comes lots of data which you can make some pretty graphs with. And there's a lot of data which comes out of these simulators, which we'll come on to. So what do these look like then? So when we put all that together, try and solve these equations, this is what the planet looks like inside a computer. So if you can, cast your minds back to how the planet looked from satellite, this is actually remarkably similar. This is just solving the fundamental equations that we have of our atmosphere. There's water vapor in the atmosphere, so you can see the white colours of water, and then the red, the heavier rainfall. That we get, so you can watch the storms come across the northern tropical regions, for example, in the UK. You can see the sort of spotty nature of water vapor in the tropical regions. You can see the daily cycle of rainfall, for example, right over Brazil and over Africa. You see this pulsing of the rain over the forest regions, for example. You see the lovely storms floating around the southern ocean. You see hurricanes and typhoons forming over the tropical Caribbean and over and engaging regions. So, you know, there's nothing in the model which says we must form a hurricane here and now. It's just generated from solving the fundamental physical equations that govern the flow in the atmosphere. Yes, you know an awful lot of meteorology to know that this is actually simulation rather than the observations, you know. But so we seem to be able to represent, like, visually at least, what's going on inside the planet, inside our computer. But we're not representing everything perfectly. You know, we would like to be able to make our mesh much smaller if possible. So we have relatively big meshes and small meshes, and we would like to be able to solve those equations on a smaller and smaller mesh to get more accurate answers. So this is just one example showing ocean currents in three different mesh sizes. On the right-hand side, we've got a very coarse mesh. You can see the blocky outline of the coasts because you can't represent the coasts at the scale. And as you go to the left, you can see those scales getting smaller and smaller and smaller. We're starting to see more and more features, and so we represent everything far more efficiently, far more effectively at the smaller mesh sizes. But of course, that means more computation. So every factor 4 in mesh size we go down, that increases our computational load by at least an order of magnitude, if not more. So we have to use more supercomputers to be able to solve the equation. At the moment, we're not quite at the level where we'd like to be, where we can solve the equations on the smallest mesh size that we would like to be able to. So what does a model look like in the oceans? This is an American model, GFPL model, for those who are interested. Apologies for the horrible color scale. I didn't make this one. This is the sea surface temperature in the ocean. Obviously, we're looking at the tropical regions now, for example. So you can see these beautiful waves and eddies in the ocean in these simulations. You can see actually see the outflow of the Amazon and other rivers flowing out into the sea. You see the lovely waves propagating across. You see the lovely eddies and the Gulf Stream, for example, in this particular version, shedding eddies as it goes across to the northeast. You can see the seasonal cycle, things are getting warmer and colder at different times of year. There's a little clock at the bottom you can watch for the month of the year. And in the tropical Pacific, we have very interesting features. We have a very dynamic system. We have tropical instability waves, beautiful waves that form, for example. So we seem to be able to represent, and you can see these features, for example, also in satellite pictures at high enough resolution as well. So we have confidence that we're representing these features relatively well. Just one point, there are a whole group of us who are trying to reduce the use of rainbow color scales in our diagrams for many different reasons. So we started the hashtag #EndRainbow for trying to point this out, and that's slowly getting some traction with the community, I think. So we can use these simulations, now we've built them, to try and answer some interesting questions. So these are all questions you might like to think about if you have a model for the planet. These are all experiments that have been done, some of them slightly crazier than others. So people have also, so what will happen if the world spun backwards? It's actually changing two numbers in the equations. So you can do that, you can spin the world backwards and see what happens. And you know, this is useful to try and test our understanding of how the system works. It turns out the ocean currents change. The Gulf Stream moves to the eastern boundary rather than the western boundary. So we can try and some fun experiments to try and test your understanding of how the system works. You can take away all the mountains, for example. Storm tracks change, where the storms go change. And as you do that, you can take away all the land completely and just have an ocean world, for example. Then start more relevant experiments you can do. Well, why don't you move the continents around or change the Earth's axis, tilt axis? And this is, of course, trying to represent what happened in the past. At different times in the past, the continents have been in different places, and the Earth's tilt and orbit has been different. And so you can do experiments to try and understand how that would change our climate. Again, more relevant, you know, what happens if a giant volcanic eruption happens? We know they happen relatively frequently. What would that do to our climate? To try, you know, you try and understand, maybe compare, for example, of what would happen if one of these eruptions occur, which it will do at some point in the future. You can take out all the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and see what happens. The temperature drops by about 30 degrees and you get ice near the equator. We can ask questions like, what if there are no humans on the planet? What would happen to our climate if that was the case? or if we make different choices about what happens in our future, we'll have lots of future greenhouse gas emissions or less greenhouse gas emissions in the future. So we ask these what if questions about our planet using these different simulators. So there's a very nice online interactive animation done by Bloomberg and NASA. I've got a couple of screenshots here about what is warming our planet. So this is the example of a planet without humans. So there's various factors which change our climate if humans weren't around. We have changes in the Earth's orbit, we have changes in solar activity, we have the volcanic eruptions, which cool the planet periodically. And so this is our the observations of the temperature, global temperature in the black line, and the blue line shows what we think would happen to our climate if only those natural factors had been at play. And they come up, those natural factors come up to play what we've seen. So you can go to this website, and there's a whole interactive animation which I think is really nice. We can repeat this with all of the factors that we can think of. We have to add in things like changes to the land use, what's happened to the changes in the land, what's happened to changes in ozone, for example, aerosols, these small particulates which are emitted by our power stations, as well as greenhouse gases, and of course we have the increasing greenhouse gases as well. And when we put all of the factors together, we actually represent what's happened to our planet really rather well. So this gives us confidence that we understand the main factors which are driving changes to our climate. And so, for example, you probably may well have heard of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, which assess all of the evidence we have for changes in our climate. They have 42 different simulators of the planet that they've used. So these models that I've shown, there are at least 40 different models across the planet, in at least 14 different countries. And this is a big data problem. So these simulations are coordinated by a formal group called CMIT. The last phase 5 of CMIT, produced about 10 petabytes of data. And that was for the last assessment report. The next big round of assessment, which is starting to happen now, we expect about 100 petabytes of data. So this is a big data problem. We're facing massive challenges in downloading and using and analyzing this type of data volume. So if you're interested in big data problems, this is one of them. Now arguably you might say, well, we must condense that into two images for relevance for policymakers. For example, people have to make decisions, they have to decide which world they'd like to live in. For example, by the end of the century we can have a choice between two futures, with a range of futures in between as well. But we have a low emissions future and a high emissions future, and they have to decide which world they would like to live in. So a world, you know, 10, 12 more degrees of warming over the Arctic, or I know, 4 or 5 degrees over the land, or a slightly cooler world. But of course, and as scientists, we struggle to try and communicate this, and I don't think we've worked out the best way of doing this yet. You know, we would definitely like input from professional people to try and improve our representation of how we communicate this information, how we communicate under the uncertainty as well. So the uncertainty is actually denoted by the little dots you see on the diagram. But they're not sure they're particularly communicative or interpretable very easily. The dots mean we've got more confidence where there are dots than areas without dots. And I think that's a pretty simple way of showing it, and I'm sure we can find better ways of doing it. So if you want to get involved, then please, I'd encourage you to ask any of the climate scientists in the room how you might be able to get involved. All this data is freely available for use. Because not just temperature, we also have rainfall changes, and actually rainfall is far more complicated. We have less dots, for example, communicating confidence. We have lots of regions without dots, but we don't really know what's going to happen to rainfall, for example. How do we communicate that information, represent that information in simple static diagrams, or maybe simple animations, simple, better visualisations to try and communicate this information, which you know is used by people making very difficult and important decisions about our future. So just to finish the last little topic then, I'd also like to talk about the weather of the past. So we can also use these models to try and fill in those gaps. So we saw right at the beginning of gaps in our knowledge because we don't have enough observations. But what we can do is use our models to interpolate, essentially, to fill in the gaps where we don't have the information, and try and understand what happened in those gaps at that time. So this is an example. So Philip Bruin, who's sitting there, has made these lovely animations trying to show the weather of the past. So this is 2013, but we have very good information. because there are very few gaps. You can see the weather systems flowing around. You can see the rainfall in black. Again, you can see it's pulsing the rain in the tropics. You can see the storms flowing across the northern edge tropics, for example. And you see the different wind patterns, the wind arrows, and so on. So this is representing the weather in 2013. And that's not, of course, how we've always been able to measure what's going on. Back in 1936, we had less observations. And so again, this is exactly the same diagram. See that, again, you can see various storms and changes. But there's two things which are different. First of all, there's yellow dots. And the yellow dots are where we have observations. So we have lots of observations over North America, over Europe. You can now see the ship tracks very, very clearly through the different canals, for example, and around the capes. There's one very other important difference, which is the fog. Now, this is not meteorological fog like we had this morning. This is what we call the fog of uncertainty or the fog of ignorance. It's where we don't have enough information to understand what happened. So we're trying to communicate that there is uncertainty. We don't have the ship tracks. You can see there's no yellow dots in those areas for us to understand what the weather is doing at that particular moment in time. So we have this is what we have to deal with. We have messy data. We have to understand that there are gaps, there's uncertainties. But we have to do the best we can to try and fill in those gaps and try and represent the data that we do have in an effective way. We can go further back in time. This is 1916. Showing the data in a slightly different way. Where you see very clear contours means we have very good information. And where you see the messy spaghetti down at the bottom shows you have very little information. I think it's actually probably look better on the sphere outside, actually. But you can get see the messiness over the polar regions where we don't have many observations. But you can see the pressure systems, the high pressure in red and low pressure in blue, the systems moving across. And this is trying to interpret what was going on with the weather in 1916. I think it's remarkable that we can even say anything about how the weather systems were doing in 1916, but by using the strength of our models to fill in the gaps between the observations we do have, we can get a pretty good estimate, actually, of what was going on in certain regions where we had good observations. And Philip's going to talk tomorrow about a project where we took Project Time Machine. This is actually going back in time and actually collecting new observations in the past. Because there are new observations, except that they're in handwritten logbooks, which have never been looked at. And there's millions and millions and millions of pages sat in various archives around the world which contain observations, weather observations which we've never looked at and haven't got digitized to use. And so we can actually go back and add in extra information to these simulations to improve our reconstruction. And this is one particular storm, for example, in 1916. You can see the sharper contours on the right-hand side. Because we've added a few extra ship observations to try and better reconstruct what's happening. So we can go back in time, better reconstruct the storms of the past, try and understand how they impacted the people back then and how that might change. I'm just going to finish with one last animation from NASA, again showing our dynamic planet, showing the different types of particles that are flowing around the atmosphere. This is from 2007. You see blue sea salt flowing around the atmosphere. You see burning particles from burning in green. You see the orange and red, which is the dust. You see what are called sulfate particles in white, which are emitted by the power stations. And you can see the flow of these different particles around the atmosphere. You can see, as I say, it's the Sahara dust flowing across the Atlantic. Even reaching the US, it reaches the UK sometimes as well. You can see the sea salt in the blue flowing around, beautiful array of colours and characteristics, and trying to simulate all this. It's a challenge, but we're getting to the stage where we can represent what's going on in all these different parts of the system, how they all interact. And I'll just wait, let's run for a moment, because I'm going to stare at it for hours. So in the moment, a volcano is going to go off near Madagascar. So you see lots of particulates emitted from near Madagascar in the moment. I'll just let this run for a little bit. 10 links that's already done basically, you can stare at them for longer as well, but you can just stare at them for hours. Okay, so the last couple of minutes, I'll just maybe talk very briefly about one recent example about why what we're doing is I think is important. This is a very recent picture from NASA's EPIC satellite, which takes pictures of the planet from beyond the orbit of the moon every few hours. You may recognise this, there's Hurricane Matthew right in the middle of the Caribbean in this particular example. So Hurricane Matthew hit Haiti and Florida very recently, a few weeks ago, caused an enormous amount of damage to those regions. And you can see the beautiful spiral arms, the swirl of Hurricane Matthew in the middle of the diagram there. I like this visualisation of past hurricanes in the Caribbean and Florida. So this is Lanzaro Gamio, who I don't know, but I like this small multiple version showing all of the storms that have gone through the Caribbean in different years, different strengths. The different colours represent different strengths of the storms as they pass through the region in different years, their names and so on, where they travelled, and so on. There's a diagram for this. Every year we have records. You can go and look at those. So obviously, hurricanes like this impact people's lives. They cause a lot of devastation, and whether or not they're getting worse or not is an open question. But of course, what's going on is as the planet is warming, sea levels are rising. So as the water gets warmer, it expands. So in this region, for example, in Florida, we have good records of sea level going back to about 1900 or so, and we can actually watch as the sea level rises by 20 to 30 centimetres over that time, since 1913. And so if you have a storm coming across and sea levels are 30 centimetres higher, then the impacts of that storm are going to be much worse than coastal flooding, for example. So what we're seeing is the effects of a warming ocean makes the impacts of these particular hurricanes that come across these regions relatively regularly much worse. And that affects people. The rising sea levels means that people get flooded and it impacts people's lives. And so what we're doing is trying to understand the changes that we're seeing, trying to communicate that. So maybe just telling stories, for example, of people like this being affected is an effective way of communicating, but we also need to try and communicate our data in better ways as well to try and get across the changes that we're seeing. Thank you.